that what brings matter and spirit together is this false ego. Because of this sense of false ego or misidentification, the spirit soul identifies himself with the matter. So, as long as that misidentification is there, the soul is entrapped in the material world, material existence. As soon as the soul gives up that false sense of identity with matter, that false ego, he is back in the spiritual world. So he is having the spiritual consciousness. Whether the soul is living in the material world or spiritual world, if his consciousness is not that of false ego, but it's true ego of identifying oneself as the part and parcel of Krishna and a servant of Krishna and performing devotional service, whatever may be the geographical location, his consciousness is spiritual, so he is not contaminated. So this relationship between the Lord, the living entity and the material body is established because of the misidentification. So that fact is being explained in the next couple of verses. So one example is given. Svapna drashtur ivanjasa. If you see the fourth line, Sukadeva Goswami says Svapna drashtur ivanjasa. A person is sleeping and during his sleep he sees a dream. In the dream, maybe he has become a king, or he may be being chased by some tiger or some robbers. He may be seeing himself as being killed by someone. So like that, he may see so many things, and because of the dreamy state, he may start identifying himself with the dream body and thinks that it is reality. So but as soon as he gets up from the sleep, then he will understand there is no tiger, there is no robber, there is nothing. So I am back to normal. So that's how he thinks. Similarly, this whole tenure of the conditioned soul in this material world is also similar to the dreamy situation only. So when the conditioned soul is misidentifying himself with this matter, material body and material paraphernalia here, then there is suffering. As soon as he is reawakened to his original identity as Krishna's eternal servant, then there is no entanglement with the material body. So when Sukadeva Goswami asked, how did this spiritual jiva attain this material body? How is this connection established? Sukadeva Goswami is establishing that there is actually no relationship. The relation is unreal. That is only existing because of maya and misidentification and false ego. So all this is because of ignorance. So Prabhupada writes in the purport, the spirit soul is distinct from the material conception of his life, but he is absorbed in such a material conception because of being influenced by the external energy. That is the influence of external energy, maya. So all the living entities' consciousness and forgetfulness are influenced by the Lord. Matta smritir jnanam apohanam cha. So that verse Prabhupada quotes here and says that even that maya is also controlled by Lord only, right? So it is Lord's maya. So because the living entity has a desire to enjoy separately from Krishna, that's why the Supreme Lord is arranging his external energy to influence him in a way that he can forget Lord and he can think himself as independent enjoyer or proprietor or controller of the Lord. So but if the living entity starts identifying himself as a servant of Krishna and not an independent enjoyer, proprietor or controller or the Lord of whatever he serves, then Lord's internal energy will influence that living entity and nourish him with the feeling of devotional service. So Lord clearly wishes that every living entity be in his pure consciousness as the part and parcel of the Lord and thus be engaged in the loving service of the Lord. As he is constitutionally made, so he is made for that. So the finger of a hand of a body is made to serve the body, right? So the constitutionally the living entity is made to serve Krishna and to love Krishna, but in the conditioned state he doesn't serve Krishna, he doesn't love Krishna, he loves something else. He wants to be served and not render service. So Krishna wishes that everyone is in his constitutional position, in a natural condition, not in an unnatural condition. But because of the false desires of the living entity, he is entangled in this material existence. And why, if Krishna wants, he can bring a transformation in the hearts of the conditioned souls and immediately reinstate them in their position as servants of Krishna. But that doesn't give much pleasure to Krishna. Because if someone is serving me out of love, that love is relishable, that service is relishable to me. But if I understand that this person is rendering this service to me out of obligation, out of duty, or out of force, that service is not relishable to me. Someone is serving me prasadam, then one may eat it if it is served with love. But if he is just throwing the plate like that, like how? So then it's not palatable, that prasadam. Although the item is very relishable, still the person who is eating would not relish it so much because it is not served with love. It is served out of force, out of obligation. That's why Krishna never interferes with the minute independence or free will that the living entity has. So it's up to the only possession the soul has is his minute independence. So he can do anything with that simple property that he has. So it's my property. Even Krishna has no influence over that minute independence. He can if he wants, but he never interferes with our possession. You are, for the rest of eternity, we are the proprietors of our own free will. So Krishna will never interfere with that. So that decision the conditioned soul has to make. Should I serve Krishna or should I serve Maya? So accordingly, Krishna will reciprocate. So if one wants to enjoy separately from Krishna, then he is in the clutches of Maya. And that's how the conditioned soul's relationship with the matter is established. So that is because of Maya. That is the answer. He says, same question is answered by, asked by Vidura to Maitreya in the third canto. Then Maitreya says that answer is similar to this. He says, only because of misidentification that the living entity is entrapped in this material body. So he gives an example. If one, it is similar to seeing one's own head cut off. If my head is cut off, can I see myself? When I say that I am seeing my head being cut off, that statement doesn't make any sense, right? If my head is cut off, how can I see? Simple. But we can see our head being cut off if we are in a dream. Similarly, all the sufferings of the spirit soul in this material world are like seeing one's own head being cut off. That is possible only in a dream. So this suffering of spirit soul, pure spirit soul, part and parcel of Krishna in this material world is possible in a dream. That dream is influence of Maya in this material world. So Prabhupada further says here, the first sinful will of living entity is to become the Lord, and the consequent will of the Lord is that living entity forget his factual life and thus dream of the land of utopia where he may become one like the Lord. So, for example, a small child, Prabhupada gives this example here. A small child is wanting to have the moon with him. And he is asking the mother, but the mother cannot give the moon to the child. So what does mother do? Mother will show a mirror. So in this mirror you can see the moon. Then child sees the moon and then he imagines that moon is with me. And then he will happily sleep or eat the food that mother is feeding or take the medicine that mother is feeding or whatever. So like that it's Maya. Similarly, the living entity is supposed to be a servant of Krishna. He cannot be independent Lord. Now he has desire to become independent from the Lord and become Lord himself. So what does the Lord do being the mother? So he just shows the mirror. The mirror is Maya. Okay, you see moon here and then think that there is moon. Okay, you see the mirror and think that the moon is with you. Similarly, you be in this material world and think that you are independent Lord. Otherwise, you cannot be independent. Like that. It's a dreamy situation. So, the crying child of the Lord is given over to the reflection, the material world, to lord it over as karmi and to give this up in frustration and become one with Lord. When someone is frustrated, the child is getting frustrated. Moon is with me, but I cannot enjoy it. I cannot touch it. I cannot do anything. If I just keep the mirror, I said moon is gone. I have to always keep like this only in the, at certain angle. Then only I can see the moon. Then only I can feel that moon is with me. Similarly, to enjoy in this material world, so many stars, conditions apply, conditions apply, conditions apply, conditions. You will enjoy by doing this, star, conditions apply, like that. So the enjoyment in this material world is not unconditional. It is subject to various conditions. And how much enjoyment you will get? Very meager enjoyment. So, sukhaya karmani karoti loko natai sukham vanya duparamam va vindeta bhuyas tata eva dukham yadattara yuktam bhagavan vadenaha. In this material world, people perform so many activities. Sukhaya karmani, to get happiness, they perform activities. Karoti loko natahi sukham vanyaduparamamva. Although they endeavor for happiness, they don't get happiness. And on top of it, they get distress. And interestingly, although they are getting distress, they will never be detached from performing activity for happiness. They will continue to perform activities to get happiness, although they get distress. And the distress is increasing only. So that is the influence of Maya. In spite of sincere endeavor to get happiness, they don't get happiness, but they don't get detached from their endeavors also. So like that, Vidura expresses his concern for the conditioned souls. So the solution is to perform devotional service. That will also come in the next verses. And what is this dream that is mentioned in this verse compared to? The dream is the conception of I and mine. So, thus only in dream does the misconception of I and mine persist life after life. But in reality, the soul, the pure spirit soul thinks that he is a servant of Krishna. I belong to Krishna. And this service is actually my connection with Krishna. That is his actual consciousness. Prabhupada summarizes the whole thing in the last three lines of the purport. In his pure consciousness, there is no such misconceived dream. And in that pure conscious state, the living entity does not forget that he is never the Lord, but that he is eternally the servitor of the Lord in transcendental love. So this is the real consciousness. Second verse. Bahurupa iva bhati,
bahurupa iva bhati,
mayaya bahurupaya,
mayaya bahurupaya,
ramamano guneshvasyam,
ramamano guneshvasyam,
mamaham iti manyate,
mamaham iti manyate.
The illusion living entity appears in so many forms offered by the external energy of the Lord. While enjoying in the modes of material nature, the encased living entity misconceives, thinking in terms of I and mine.
See, bahurupa iva bhati. So this conditioned living entity who is influenced by Maya assumes so many forms. Bahurupa iva bhati. So sometimes he is in the form of a tiger, sometimes cow, sometimes human being, sometimes male, sometimes female, sometimes insect. So like that, mayaya bahurupaya, influenced by the external energy of the Lord, he takes up so many forms in this material world. Ramamano guneshvasya mamaham iti manyate. Ramamano. So he enjoys. How does he enjoy? Guneshvasya. By the influence of material modes of nature, he enjoys some illusory enjoyment. Mamaham iti manyate. What is the mentality there? It's me and it is mine. I and mine. So with this conception, he enjoys in these modes. So these different forms are like different dresses of the living entity. So even in the material nature, there is a chance of an independent choice by the living entity. And according to his choice, the material energy offers him different varieties of material bodies. So he uses his independence to behave in a certain way, to desire in a certain way. So reciprocating with his desire and with his mentality, with his inclinations, with his activities, Maya gives him some body. That is Bahurupa Ivabhati. So Prabhupada says that there are 84 lakhs of varieties of bodies in this world, in different planets. So the living entity is traveling by so many transmigrations according to different modes of enjoying spirit within himself. Right? Ramamano Guneshvasya. So by this gunas, he is Ramamano, enjoying. So that enjoyment is always accompanied with a lot of suffering. What is that verse? Soham Vrunam Kshulla Sukhaya Dukkham Mahadgatanam Viramayatasya. So for Kshulla Sukha, for meager amount of happiness, there is Mahad Dukkham. There is tremendous amount of distress. So, and if he is intelligent enough, he can desire to get a spiritual body to enjoy the company of the Lord, and he will get it. It's all about desire. So, spiritual life or material life, it's all about desire management. So, how the soul manages his desires. If he desires on a material platform, he can continue here. So, Maya will give him so many bodies. Bahurupa iva bhati mayaya bahurupaya. But if he desires to render some spiritual service or do some spiritual activity, then that is also available for him. Right? Krishna will give him entrance into spiritual world. Okay, you can be with me like that. So, the karmi thinks of this world as mine and the jnani thinks I am everything. So, forgetfulness of the real nature of the living entity and the whole misconception of the bewildered living entity can be removed by the association of pure devotees like Sukadeva Goswami and Parikshit Maharaj. So, all this is explained in Bhagavatam, like that proposes. So, because of this misconceptions of mamaham, me and mine, there are desires. So, all the desires are influenced by these conceptions of me and mine. So, because of the desires, there are so many bodies. That is the gist of this verse. Now, third verse. Third verse gives the solution. First two verses are giving the problem. What was the problem? So, the jiva and the body, material body, are connected only because of maya. Because of jiva's desire and enjoying propensity separate from the Lord, maya gives him so various forms. Bahurupa iva bhati. So, what is the solution? Third verse says, Yarhivava mahim nisve, Parasmin kalamayayo, Rametagata sammohaha, Tyakto daste tadobhayam.
As soon as the living entity becomes situated in his constitutional glory and begins to enjoy the transcendence beyond time and material energy, he at once gives up the misconceptions of life, that is I and mine, and thus becomes fully manifested as the pure devotee, pure self.
So, yarhi vava mahim nisve, if that soul chooses to engage in the devotional service of the Lord, parasmin, of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, who is kala maya yoho, who is beyond the influence of kala, time factor, and maya, the material energy. So, time and material energy, kala and maya, can influence a conditioned soul, not the Supreme Lord. But if that same conditioned soul takes shelter of a person who is beyond kala and maya, he can also come out of the influence of kala and maya. So, then what will happen? Mahimnisve. Mahimnisve means one's own glory. The living entity is situated back in his own glory of being the servant of Krishna. So, mahimnisve mahiyate. Even in the third canto also similar verse comes. Then what will happen? Rameta gata sammoha tyaktva daste tadobhayam. So, Rameta means enjoying. So, in the previous verse, if you see in the third line, what does it come? Ramamano Guneshvasya. In the second verse, the living entity's enjoyment in matter is described. Ramamano Guneshvasya. So, he is enjoying and then under the influence of material modes. So, in the third verse, Rameta Gata Sammohaha Parasmin. He will enjoy the transcendence. He will enjoy his spiritual service to Krishna. So, the second verse is describing soul's enjoyment on a material platform. Third verse is describing soul's enjoyment beyond the material platform on a spiritual platform. Right? Rameta gata sammohaha. Gata sammoha means he is completely freed from this misconception. What was the misconception? Go to the previous verse. Mama aham iti manyate. Mama aham iti manyate. He thinks himself, he thinks in terms of I and mine. So that sammoha, that kind of bewilderment or misconception of thinking in terms of one, my and mine, me and mine, is gone. Then he will actually enjoy. So soul is meant for enjoyment only. So soul will anandamayo bhyasat. So everybody is looking for enjoyment. But in a conditioned state, they look for material enjoyment. In a liberated state, they look for spiritual enjoyment. So, tyaktva udaste tado bhayam. Tyaktva udaste means he will completely give up. Udaste is fullness. He will completely give up what? Tada ubhayam. What is that ubhayam? Ubhayam means two. Both. He will give both. Give up both. Both means the conceptions of both I and mine. So once he gives up the conceptions of I and mine, then he will come out of the influence of Maya, come out of the influence of Kala, and he performs devotional service to Krishna, and then he really enjoys. That is being situated in his original glory, Mahim Nisve. That is the verse. Very beautiful verse. So devotional service actually reinstates a soul in its original glory. So what a thing is meant for, we need to use it for that thing. For example, say this table is not standing properly. So one of the four legs is little, what to say, shorter. Then it's constantly shaking, right? It's making sound. Now I'll take this phone and put it under that and table will not move. But is it the purpose for which the phone is meant for? You can connect to anyone in the world through the phone. And the job which it is doing, any paper can do. Take some paper, small, rejected paper, and then fold it and then keep it under it. Right? Take a small piece of wood and put it. Right? So, for that purpose, you can't use this. Right? Which is costly or which is so expensive. Similarly, the soul is a very crude example. The soul is meant to enjoy in a spiritual plane by loving Krishna and by serving Krishna in the spiritual world. And now he is looking for some meager enjoyment in a material plane here. So it is compared to dogs going from one house to another house, one door to another door. Right? What is that verse? Kshutparito yada dinaha. So a dog goes to one house, so it may get danda. Another house, he may get a small piece of chapati. So like that, dog is going from one house to another house. Sometimes he gets little happiness, sometimes he gets lot of distress. Similarly, soul is also going from one body to another body, one planet to another planet, one universe to another universe in search for material happiness, and he is not getting it. But in the spiritual world, there is perpetual happiness. So that is being situated in one's original glory. Mahim Nisve Mahiyate. So in the lower stages of conception, mine is very prominent, and in little higher stages, I is prominent, I and mine. So Prabhupada connects this I and mine to Jnani's mentality and Karmi's mentality. But Prabhupada gives the right example, right explanation of I and mine. But the real significance of I can be realized only when one is situated in the consciousness of I am the eternal servitor of the Lord. So that is the real I. This is pure consciousness. The misconception of I am the Lord and I am the Supreme is more dangerous than misconception of mine. So in the lower stages, mine. This is my phone, this is my table, this is my book, this is my camera. So like that, people will have this possessiveness and think that it is mine. Then that is like Karmi mentality. When someone comes to Jnani mentality, I am God. I am the worshipable. You start offering me worship. So like that, he says, I am. So these are misconceptions in this material world. So undoubtedly there is oneness, and that I am is correct. The oneness of the living entity with the Lord in many respects. Satchitananda, both are Satchitananda, both are spiritual. But ultimately the living entity is subordinate to the Lord, and he is constitutionally meant for satisfying the senses of the Lord. Both are spiritual, but one is subordinate spirit soul, another is master, predominating predominator, one, other one is the predominator spirit. So can a living entity who claims to be as good as the Supreme Being control the material nature? No, he says. They may claim that we will do it in future. Future also. Why is one now under the control of Maya? Okay, we agree that in future you will become supreme. But what about now? You are unable to control the material nature. When you get headache, you will also take some medicine. So they have no answer to this. So like that, Prabhupada argues. As long as one is a servant of material, mental concoctions, one cannot be completely freed from the disease of I and mine. So the living entity has to be situated in the transcendental position where there is no more influence of time or material energy. So that is mamchayo avyabhicharena bhakti yogena sevate. So that is parasmin kalamayayoho. So Prabhupada gives the summary and the conclusion in the last paragraph. You can see the perfect process is to accept Lord Vasudeva as the supreme in everything. And the best perfection in culturing knowledge is to surrender unto him. And because he is the source of everything, only in that conception can one get rid of this misconception of I and mine. So accepting Krishna as the supreme and surrendering oneself unto the service of that supreme is the way of coming out of this misconceptions of I and mine. So that is being reinstated in one's own glory. Mahim nisve mahiyati. So he explained answer to the first question. So what was the question of Parikshit Maharaj? Why there is a relation between the soul and material body? Answer is because of misidentification, because of Maya. It is only in that Maya only one thinks in terms of I and mine, mamaham. And how to come out of it? By performing devotional service. Right? So then the enjoyment on a material plane will transform into enjoyment on a spiritual plane. So now Parikshit asked so many other questions. So those questions are answered by quoting Brahma Narada Samvad, Brahma and Lord Samvad. So Lord and Brahma also had a discussion right in the beginning of the creation. So some of the questions of Parikshit will be answered through that. So it's a recurring theme in Bhagavatam that when a question is asked by an inquirer, the hearer, the speaker will sometimes answer himself, or many times he quotes from some other speaker. Oh, the answer to this question was answered by, say, Brahmaji or the Lord in so and so context, and then they will narrate that context like that. Now, in the next 5 verses, we will see a background, a prelude to the conversation between the Lord and Brahma. What happened before they actually conversed? Atmatattva Vishuddhyartham
Yadaha
Bhagavan Ritam
Brahmane Darshayan Rupam
Avyalika Vratadrataha.
King, the personality of Godhead, he very much pleased with Lord Brahma because of his non-deceptive finances in yoga, presented in eternal and transcendent form of Brahma. And that is the objective goal of purifying the condition.
Atma Tattva Vishuddhyartham Yadaha Bhagavan Ritam. So here, Sukadeva Goswami is saying that in the beginning of creation, Brahmaji, he did some penance, right? So how did he do that penance? What was the motivation behind that penance? Avyalika vratadrataha. Vrata means vow, whatever practices one does. Avyalika or nirvyalika means without any deception, without any malice, without any bad intentions, right? Purity, basically. So avyalika vratadrataha. So without any deceptive motives, he performed penance in bhakti yoga. Then Brahmane Darshayan Rupam. Then the Lord has manifested his beautiful transcendental form and even the spiritual world in front of Brahmaji's vision. So Brahmaji attained the vision of the Lord and the spiritual abode by performing non-deceptive penance. Avyalika Vrata. So Atma Tattva Vishuddhyartham. He could understand the science of Atma. Science of Atma. Atma is two types. One is Atma, one is Paramatma. Supreme Lord and the living entity. So Jivatma and Paramatma. So Atma Tattva means understanding the science of both the Jiva, living entity, and the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That is called Atma Tattva. But problem is, sometimes people may have different wrong conceptions about this Atma Tattva. The real definition of Atma Tattva is to understand the Supreme Lord as the ultimate controller of everything that be, and the Jivatma as a servitor of that Supreme Lord. Jivatma is a servitor of that Paramatma. But generally people have wrong conceptions. What is the wrong conception about Jivatma? Identifying oneself with the material body. That is the wrong conception about Jivatma. What is the wrong conception about Paramatma? To think that Paramatma and this Atma are on the same level. So bringing down that Paramatma to a mundane level or to a level of the part and parcel living entity is a misconception about him. It's minimizing his glory. And thinking oneself with a material body means minimizing the soul's glory also. Right? So basically minimizing the glory is misconception, is wrong conception about Atma and Paramatma. So that's what Prabhupada explains here. But this misconception about Atma, Jivatma and Paramatma can be completely vanquished by one stroke of Bhakti Yoga. Prabhupada writes that, removed by one stroke of Bhakti Yoga. Just as sunlight, when sunlight comes, one can see oneself properly, one can see the sun properly, one can see everything around him also properly. In the darkness, one cannot see oneself also, one cannot see the sun, one cannot see anything around. So, what is that appearance of sun indicate? That is appearance of Bhakti Yoga. When one performs Bhakti, one can understand the position of the Supreme Lord nicely, one can understand one's own position, one can understand one's relationship between the Lord and himself and the people around him. Right circumstances, one can see the situation in his life in proper perspective, one can see other living entities in proper perspective, one can see the Lord in proper perspective, and one can see the nature, the material world also in the proper perspective. Everything has connection with Krishna. Without Krishna, then no one has any proper understanding about anything. So to understand Atma Tattva, one needs Bhakti Yoga. Simple. And in the second paragraph, first paragraph is about Atma Tattva. Second paragraph, Prabhupada explains about the Lord's form. So the form of the Lord is Sachidananda, eternal, full of knowledge and full of bliss. So the Jiva also has a spiritual form. But by the influence of material energy, one cannot understand the form of oneself, one's own Swarupa and the Swarupa of the Lord also. But by one stroke of Bhakti Yoga, by performing Bhakti Yoga, one can have the proper understanding about the Supreme Lord's form and one's own form also. So this is an answer to the second question of Parikshit Maharaj. Parikshit Maharaj asked about the second question, asked the question, what is the difference between the body of the living entity and the Lord? The difference is this. Both of their bodies are spiritual. But in the material world, when the soul becomes conditioned in the material existence, his body is material. But whether the Lord is in the material world or spiritual world, in the spiritual world as eternal enjoyer or in the material world in the form of an incarnation, his body is always spiritual. That is the difference between their bodies. Right? So, the last paragraph is very wonderful. He says, the topic of Srimad Bhagavatam is the science of both the Lord and the living entity. So, the verse is starting with Atma Tattva. We understood what is Atma Tattva. So, Atma Tattva is the subject matter of Bhagavatam, he says, in one sense. So, regular reading or hearing of Srimad Bhagavatam is also performance of Bhakti Yoga. What did Prabhupada say some time back? Atma Tattva is this, and one can understand Atma Tattva by Bhakti Yoga. And one can understand Bhagavatam, one can understand Atma Tattva by studying Bhagavatam. So, studying Bhagavatam is also Bhakti Yoga. So, regular reading or hearing of Srimad Bhagavatam is also performance of Bhakti Yoga, and one can attain the highest perfection simply by association of Srimad Bhagavatam. Both Sukadeva Goswami and Parikshit Maharaj are an example for this. Both are associating with Bhagavatam through speaking and through hearing. Fifth verse. Saadi Devo Jagatam Paro Guru.
Saadi Devo Jagatam Paro Guru.
Svadhishnyamasthaya Sisriksha Yaishkshatam.
Svadhishnyamasthaya Sisriksha.
Tamnadhyagachadrishamartra Sammatam.
Tamnadhyagachadrishamartra Sammatam.
Prapancha Nirmana Vidhur. Yaya bhavet.
Lord Brahma, the first spiritual master, supreme in the universe, couldn't trace out the source of his lotus feet, and while thinking of creating the material world, couldn't understand the proper direction for such creative work, nor could he find out the process of such creation.
Sa adi devo jagatam paro guruhu. So, Jagatam Paroguruhu means a supreme spiritual master of entire universe. So that Brahmaji, who is the first spiritual master of this universe, he is the first person in the universe. So he is the first guru also in the universe. So he could not trace out the source of his lotus seed. So he took birth from the lotus that sprouted from the navel of Garbhodaka Sai Vishnu. So he manifested there, but he could not understand, how did I end up here? What is the source of this lotus? So he tried to trace out also, going into the stem. He went all the way till the navel of the Lord, but still he couldn't figure out. So Prabhupada simply explains this, unless one has the Lord's sanction, he cannot understand everything, anything. Even in the case of Brahmaji also. So at that time, the Lord wanted Brahmaji to do tapasya. You meditate on me, you perform bhakti yoga, then I will reveal myself to you. Now stop your personal endeavors. That is the Lord's instruction to Brahmaji. So he tried to trace out the source of his lotus seed and he could not understand proper direction. So nor he could find the process of such creation. So Prabhupada writes that this verse is a prelude for explaining the transcendental nature of the form and abode of the Lord. The kingdom of God is not a myth, but factually a different and transcendental sphere of planets known as the Vaikunthas. So the knowledge of that spiritual sky, the knowledge of the Supreme Lord, even the knowledge about one's own spiritual position also is possible only by practice of Bhakti Yoga. So many of these verses in this section are a direct glorification of Bhakti Yoga, and especially the purports of Prabhupada just bring out that theme, that how Bhakti Yoga is most effective process, and in fact the only process to understand Krishna. Because in the spiritual world, we don't see anyone sitting and meditating on the Paramatma. There are no Paramatma meditators in the spiritual world. There are no karmis who are endeavoring to attain heavenly planets in the spiritual world. And definitely there are no gnanis who are trying to merge into the effulgence of the Lord in the spiritual world. So in the spiritual world, this karmis, gnanis, yogis trying to attain astasiddhis, they are not there. Only bhakti yogis are there. That means bhaktas, the profile of bhakta is eternal, but the profile of karmi, gnani, yogi is restricted to this material world only. It has no place in the eternal world. Similarly, bhakti yoga is a transcendental process. And Bhakti Yoga is an eternal process. All the other processes exist only in the material world. So by performing Bhakti Yoga, one is endeavoring to enter an eternal, a life of eternity. All others are not lives of eternities. So they are restricted. They have some ending. So such knowledge of the spiritual sky can be known by the dint of devotional service or Bhakti Yoga. The power of creation by Lord Brahma was achieved only by Bhakti Yoga. By Bhakti Yoga, one can know the Lord, and by knowing the Lord as the Supreme, one is able to know everything else. Even the first spiritual master of the universe, that is Jagatam Paro Guruhu, he also practiced Bhakti Yoga only to create this universe. The beginning of the universe actually started with Bhakti Yoga. The first activity that is done within this universe is performance of Bhakti Yoga. Right. So to seek knowledge and strength of one's own personal attempt is a sheer waste of time. So Brahmaji is unable to figure out the source of this lotus. At this time he is little in bewilderment or surprise. What am I supposed to do? At that time he hears something interesting. That is the sixth verse. Sachintayan dhas chaksharam ekadam bhasi upashrunodvir gaditam vacho vibhu
sparsheshu yat shodasham ekavimsham
sparsheshu yat shodasham ekavimsham
nishkinchana nam rupayadhanam vidu
nishkinchana nam rupayadhanam vidu.
Why is this engaged in thinking in the water? Brahmaji heard twice from two syllables joined together. One of the syllables was taken from the 16th and the other from the 21st of these Persh alphabets, and both joined to become the wealth of the renounced order of life.
Interesting verse. So Chintayan, as Brahmaji is contemplating like that, he was thinking, what is the source of this lotus? Dvaksharam. Ekada means once upon a time. That is in the beginning of the creation. Dvaksharam. Dvi aksharam. Ambhasi upashrunot. He had two aksharas, two syllables. So, what are they? Sparshyashu yat shodasham ekavimsham. So, in the sparsha syllables, he had the 16th syllable combined with the 21st syllable, that is ta and pa, right? So in a very cryptic way, Sukadeva Goswami is saying, he could have said tapa, but he has spent one full line for it. That's the poetry. So what is the significance of this tapa? Fourth line says, nishkinchana nam rupayat dhanam viduhu. Nishkinchana means one who is in the renounced order of life. Nishkinchanasya bhagavat bhajanon mukhasya param param jigimisho bhavasagarasya. So one who is in the renounced order of life has to be completely detached from material enjoyment, even to the extent of not visiting very wealthy, materially puffed up people, or not having association of opposite sex. So like that, he needs to be away from that. So nishkinchananam nirpa yad dhanam viduhu. Dhanam means the wealth. What is the wealth of such nishkinchananam people? What is the wealth of a renunciant? This two, tapa. So third line is the combination of the 16th syllable and the 21st syllable, which is tapa. And that tapa is the dhanam, the wealth of nishkinchana, renunciants. So for renunciants, tapa is most important. So in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, there is a verse that explains that Mahaprabhu are bhaktagana vairagya pradhan. So for all the devotees of Lord Chaitanya, this vairagya, this renunciation is very key factor. And what is the key factor of renunciation? What is the wealth in renunciation? Tapa. Tapa is one's wealth. So wealth is the austerity for brahmanas. So this penance is the beauty and wealth of brahmanas and the renounced lot of life. So this tapa or penance was begun from very beginning of creation, and it was first adopted by the Supreme Spiritual Master, Lord Brahma. By tapasya only one can get profit of human life. So even Rishabhadeva also says, Nayam deho deha bhajam riloke kashtan kama narhate vidbhujamye tapo divyam putraka yena sattvam shuddhyadyasmat brahma saukhyam tvanantam. So if one is fortunate enough to get human life, he should not waste that human life in the trivial activities of eating, sleeping, mating and fearing. So that even animals also do. So nayam deho deha bhajam ruloke. And he says kashtan kaman. If one has kama, he will definitely get kashta, right? And that is common to even vidbhujamye, stool eaters, like hogs and dogs. So if the activity of a human being and these animals is matching, so what is the speciality of a human being? So he can do something more. What is that? Tapo divyam putrakayena sattvam. Tapo divyam, he has to do tapa. Austerity, he has to accept some inconvenience voluntarily to gain something higher. Tapo divyam putrakayena sattvam shuddhet. One has to purify his heart by performing tapasya. Brahma saukhyam tvanantam. Then he can attain the spiritual happiness. Right? So otherwise, the animals are endeavoring for material happiness through eating, sleeping, mating, defending. So if human being also endeavors for material happiness, what is the difference? He has to endeavor for spiritual happiness. And how does he get access to that spiritual happiness? By tapa. So Prabhupada quotes that here. He doesn't mention the verse, but that's what the gist of the verse he presents here. Okay, next verse. Seventh verse. Nishamya tadvaktru didrikshaya disho.
Nishamya tadvaktru didrikshaya disho.
Vilokya tatra anyad apashyamanah.
Vilokya tatra anyad apashyamanah.
Svadhishnyam asthaya vimrishya tadhitam.
Svadhishnyam asthaya vimrishya tadhitam.
Tapasyupadishta ivada dhemanah.
Tapasyupadishta ivada dhemanah.
When he heard the sound, he tried to find the speaker, searching on all sides. But when he was unable to find anyone besides himself, he thought it wise to sit down on his lotus seat firmly and give his attentions to the execution of penance as he was instructed.
So, Nishamya means Brahmaji has heard the 16th and 21st syllable combined together. He has heard the word tapa, tapa, like that. But tad vaktru didrikshayadishu, the vakta, who is the speaker of that verse, a speaker of those words, tapa, he didn't understand. And he had no facility to ask someone also, who spoke? You are searching for something in this room. For example, you lost your pen or pencil and then you are searching for something in the room and you suddenly hear from the speaker or somewhere, right? It's there in the left corner. On the eastern side of the room, behind that chair, something like that. Right? And you don't find a speaker. And if somebody is around, then you try to ask him. There's no one around. He's the only person. And he has heard this voice, he doesn't know who is the speaker. So, vilokya tatranyat apashyamanaha. Vilokya, he has seen everywhere. Who is the speaker? Who said tapa? He was trying to search everywhere. Control F. He said his search did not work. So, then what did he think? Svadhishnyam asthaya vimrishya tadhitam. Svadhishnyam. He started sitting down in his own dhishnya, in his own seat, lotus seat. He was born on a lotus flower. He sat in his own lotus seat and he felt that instead of searching for the speaker, whoever has given me this instruction, so let me follow the instruction. They said tapa. Let me follow, do that tapa. I am not finding who said tapa. Let me do tapa. So he started doing tapa. So he thought it wise to sit down and do tapa. Don't waste time like that. So tapasyapadishta ivadadhe manaha. So to achieve success in life, one should follow the example of Brahma. Prabhupada's first statement. What is that? Actually, Brahmaji was initiated now. He was searching for the guru. And then his guru told him, do tapasya. But guru was invisible now. And he was initiated, after being initiated by the Supreme Lord to execute tapasya, he was fixed in his determination to do it. So, accepting a guru's instruction and executing that instruction with great determination is the duty of a disciple. The disposition of a disciple is, he is just ready and willing to accept the instruction and execute it without any pretense. That is avyalika. The fourth verse it is said, avyalika vratadrataha. Avyalika means without any deception, deceptive motives. So the Lord is within every living entity as super soul, and he initiated Brahma because Brahma was willing to receive initiation. The Lord can similarly initiate everyone who is inclined to have it. So Prabhupada writes in this purport that Brahmaji had the facility to get initiated by the Lord. Lord told him what to do. But everyone may not be getting that facility. But one can have the same facility through Lord's representatives, through the unalloyed devotees of the Lord, through scriptural instructions. The Lord himself appears as spiritual master to a person who is sincere in heart about serving the Lord. Therefore, a bona fide spiritual master who happens to meet the sincere devotee should be accepted as the most confidential and beloved representative of the Lord. So, not everyone has the facility to directly hear instruction from the Lord. So, one can hear that instruction from a bona fide spiritual master, right, who is connected to the Lord. That's what Prabhupada says. Now, Brahmaji is following that instruction. He thought it wise to do the tapasya. Now, he will do tapasya for 100 celestial years. That is the next verse. Divyam sahasrabdham amogha darshano.
Divyam sahasrabdham amogha darshano.
Jitanilatma vijitobha yendriya.
అతప్యుతస్మాఖిలలోకతాపనం తపస్తపీయాం స్తపతాం సమాహితః.
Lord Brahma underwent penance for 1000 years by the calculation of the demigods. He heard this transcendental vibration from the sky and he accepted it as divine. Thus he controlled his mind and senses, and the penances he executed were a great lesson for the living entities. Thus he known as the greatest of all ascetics.
So divyam sahasrardham. So Brahmaji has performed tapasya for sahasra abdham. So sahasra is 1000 years. Divyam sahasra abdham. Divya means these 1000 years are not of human calculation. It is demigod calculation, celestial calculation. So he did like that. Demigod years. Then amogha darshano. So amogha darshana means one's darshan, one's vision is spotless. Right? One who has a spotless vision is called amogha darshana. So it's complete, spotless, without any tinge of impurity. So, jitanilatma vijito bhayendriyaha. And how exactly he has done the tapasya, the duration is mentioned and his vision is mentioned. And jita vijita atma. So, he has controlled his anila, life airs, and also his mind and also his senses. Right? So, having perfect control over his mind, life air and senses, he has executed penance. Atapyata. Atapyata means executed penance. Sma akhila tapanam, for the enlightening of all planets. Right? And tapaha tapiyan tapatam samahitaha. He is considered best of all those, all renunciants, best of all persons who are performing austerity. Tapasvi means one who performs austerity. He is the best of all tapasvis. Like that. He is the greatest of all ascetics. So, Prabhupada makes an interesting observation here. Brahmaji did not hear the speaker, did not see the person, but he took the words of a person as good as the person. Right? If he directly tells me, then only I will do. Not like that. I have heard what he wants me to do through some other medium. Right? Through some other person or through his representative or just heard the sound. So I will follow. So that means there is no difference between the Supreme Personality of Godhead and his sound, the sound vibration he makes. So Brahmaji took the sound of the Lord as the Lord, Lord's personal instruction. So the potency of transcendental sound is never minimized because the vibrator is apparently absent. Therefore, Bhagavatam or Gita or any revealed scripture in the world is never to be accepted as an ordinary mundane sound without transcendental potency. So the sound vibration made by the Lord in the form of Bhagavad Gita, the sound vibration which is describing the Lord in the form of Bhagavatam, so both are as good as the Lord, both carry the transcendental potency, spiritual potency. So, Prabhupada writes in the next two paragraphs very important lines about a disciple's dedication to a guru. One has to receive the transcendental sound from the right source, accept it as reality, and prosecute the direction without hesitation. So, first receive, then accept it at heart and execute it without any hesitation. So the secret of success is to receive the sound from right source of a bona fide spiritual master. Once one understands that he is the right source, then there is no hesitation. There is no hesitation in execution. So mundane manufactured sound has no potency. So Prabhupada also emphasizes on one needs to accept the sound vibration from bona fide sources. One should be qualified enough to discern such transcendental potency, and either by discriminating or by fortunate chance, if one is able to receive the transcendental sound from the bona fide spiritual master, his path of liberation is guaranteed. How do we ensure that someone is bona fide if he is connected to another bona fide person? How is he bona fide if he is connected to another bona fide person? Like that, ఇట్ కనెక్ట్స్ టు కృష్ణ. కస్మయ్యేన విభాషితోయమతులో జ్ఞాన ప్రదీప పుర తద్రూపేణ తద్రూపేణ చ నారదాయ మునయే కృష్ణాయ తద్రూపిణ యోగీంద్రాయ తదాత్మనాథ భగవద్ రాతాయ కారుణ్యతః తత్శుద్ధం విమలం విశోకమమృతం సత్యం పరం ధీమహి. సో బ్రహ్మాజీ హ్యాజ్ రిసీవ్డ్ భాగవతం ఫ్రమ్ కృష్ణ అండ్ బ్రహ్మాజీ స్పోక్ ఇట్ టు నారద, నారదముని స్పోక్ ఇట్ టు వ్యాసదేవ్, వ్యాసదేవ్ స్పోక్ ఇట్ టు సుఖదేవ్ గోస్వామి, సుఖదేవ్ గోస్వామి స్పోక్ టు సుత గోస్వామి అండ్ పరీక్షిత్ మహారాజ్. లైక్ దట్ దిస్ ఎంటైర్ లీనియేజ్ ఇస్ కనెక్టింగ్ టు కృష్ణ. సో వెదర్ కృష్ణ ఇస్ స్పీకింగ్ ఆర్ బ్రహ్మాజీ ఇస్ స్పీకింగ్ ఆర్ నారదముని ఇస్ స్పీకింగ్ ఆర్ వ్యాసదేవ్ ఇస్ స్పీకింగ్ ఆర్ సుత గోస్వామి ఇస్ స్పీకింగ్ ఆర్ పరీక్షిత్ ఇస్ స్పీకింగ్, ఇట్ ఈస్ కృష్ణ హూ ఇస్ స్పీకింగ్ త్రూ దెమ్. సో వన్ హ్యాస్ టు ఎన్ష్యూర్ దట్ ఈస్ హీ కనెక్టెడ్ టు ద బోనఫైడ్ డిసైపులిక్ సక్సెషన్ విచ్ ఈస్ కనెక్టెడ్ టు కృష్ణ. Following the order of a bona fide spiritual master is the only duty of a disciple. And this completely faithful execution of the order of the bona fide spiritual master is the secret of success. The secret of success lies in one's obedience to the spiritual master and one's sincerity in executing his instructions. That is the success.
Here, spiritual master refers to Diksha Guru what?
Both. According to Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita, both Siksha Guru and Diksha Guru are representatives of Krishna. They are expansions of Krishna. That's why right in the first verse of Chaitanya Charitamrita, Kaviraj Goswami offers this prayer. Vande Gurun Isha Bhaktan Isham Isha Avatarakan Tat Prakashamsa Tat Shaktihi Krishna Chaitanya Samyakam. These are the six diversities of one absolute truth. So one absolute truth, Supreme Lord Krishna manifests himself in six features. Vande Gurun. He doesn't say Guru, Gurun, multiple Gurus. There is one Diksha Guru, but there are multiple Siksha Gurus. So all these are representatives of Krishna. Vande Gurun, Isha Bhaktan, devotees are also representatives of Krishna. Isham, Lord is directly himself. Isham, Isha Avatarakan, his incarnations. Tat Prakashamsa, his expansions. Tat Shaktihi, his potencies. So these are the six diversities of absolute truth.
The instruction coming from Siksha Guru also has the all
potency. So, provided the personality is representing his spiritual master transparently, like that. So, controlling the senses means engaging them in the transcendental service of the Lord. The Lord's order descends in disciplic succession through the bona fide spiritual master, and thus execution of the order of the bona fide spiritual master is factual control of senses. The factual control of senses is engaging those senses in the execution of the instructions of spiritual master. And Prabhupada makes another brilliant statement, something similar in the fourth canto. The perfection of meditation is meditating on the instructions of spiritual master. Meditation and instruction of spiritual master, execution of the instructions of spiritual master. These are the perfection of one's activities and mind. So that is the factual control of senses, he says. Because Prabhupada writes in the fourth canto again, our desires for sense gratification, our senses have so many desires because the living entity is constantly trying to bring his senses in contact with the sense objects. Matra sparshe chaya muhuhu. Etadhi atura chittana matra sparshe chaya muhuhu. He is constantly trying to bring his senses in sense objects for enjoyment. So, but we understand that the sense gratificatory desires are detrimental to one's spiritual progress. We have to stop the sense gratificatory desires. So, how to stop the sense gratificatory desires? So, our sense gratificatory desires are like ripples on a river that will never stop. Will the ripples on a river stop? Never. Similarly, our desires for sense gratification also will never stop. But when the river meets the ocean, the oceanic tides will overwhelm these insignificant ripples on a river. That means, when a disciple meets the spiritual master and agrees to execute the instructions of the spiritual master, his own desires for sense gratification, which are like ripples on a river, will be overwhelmed by the plans of spiritual master for Krishna's service, which are like oceanic tides. So, to not be overwhelmed with the insignificant ripples of our sense gratification, which are unlimited, which are continuous. One has to have the humility to submit to the instructions of spiritual master, which are like oceanic tides, and overwhelm oneself with those desires by executing them. So, factual control of senses is execution of the order of bona fide spiritual master. So, he executed it. For 1000 celestial years, Brahmaji performed tapasya. Right? So, divyam sahasrabdhim amogha darshanam. Then, he got the darshan of Mahavaikuntha. That is described in the next 9 verses. 10 verses.
Tasmai svalokam bhagavan sabhajitah.
Tasmai svalokam bhagavan sabhajitah.
Sandarshayama saparam natyat param.
Sandarshayama saparam natyat param.
Vyapeta sanklesha vimoha sadhasam.
Vyapeta sanklesha vimoha sadhasam.
Svadrishtavadbhir purushair abhishtutam.
Svadrishtavadbhir purushair abhishtutam.
To the standard of God, being thus very much satisfied with the tenets of Lord Brahma, was pleased to manifest his personal abode by doing so. The spiritual plan above all others, this transcendental abode of the Lord is adored by all self-realized persons, free from all kinds of disease and fear of illusory existence.
Tasmai svalokam bhagavan sabhajitah. Sabhajitah means Brahmaji, when he performed penance, the Lord has become very pleased. Oh, he followed my instruction. So in one line, Sukadeva Goswami summarized, but what Brahmaji has done is 1000 years of tapasya. Right? It's coming as a like, in the between the previous verse and the current verse, 1000 years passed. For these 1000 years, Brahmaji is doing bhakti yoga. Brahmaji is doing tapasya. Tasmai svalokam bhagavan sabhajitah. Lord is very pleased with this endeavor of Brahmaji, and he manifested his own abode. Svalokam, his own abode, Vaikuntha. Sandarshayam, asaparam yat param, na yat param. So, what is the quality of that abode? Vyapeta sanklesha vimoha sadhvasam. In that spiritual abode of Vaikuntha, there are no sankleshas. Sanklesha, klesha, or difficulties or calamities. So Prabhupada writes that this sanklesha actually means 5 kinds of material afflictions. He explains that in the purport without quoting the actual Sanskrit terminologies, but Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur writes, they are simply avidya, asmita, raga, dvesha, abhinivesha. So vyapeta sanklesha vimoha sadhasa means spiritual world does not have these 5 kinds of material afflictions of avidya, ignorance. Then, asmita is material conception. Then, raga, attachment. Dvesha, aversion. Abhinivesha is absorption in material activities. So, these 5 things are not existing in the spiritual world. So, then sadhasam. Svadrishtavadbhir purushaha abhishtutam. So, and he is also worshipped by so many self-realized persons. Svadrishtavadbhihi means one who has completely realized oneself. So, such perfected beings are worshipping the Supreme Lord. How much perfect he must be? All perfected beings are worshipping this person. He must be really perfect. So, Lord is being worshipped like that. So, Prabhupada says, the troubles of penance accepted by Lord Brahma were certainly in line of devotional service, bhakti. Otherwise, why would he get kingdom? Why would he see spiritual kingdom? Vaikuntha? So, unless one performs bhakti yoga, he cannot see Bhagavan in the spiritual world. So, Brahmaji is seeing that. That means he performed bhakti yoga only, not other, any other mystic yoga. So, there is undoubtedly trouble in executing penance, but the trouble is, trouble in executing bhakti yoga is accompanied by a lot of happiness and pleasure. Kevala Ananda Kanda, we say, right? So, but in the other processes, there is lot of trouble, but it is not compensated by any transcendental happiness during execution, and definitely no highest result at the end of execution also. But bhakti yoga is such a process where after perfection also you continue the same activity. That means you are already engaged in a transcendental activity from now only. Because
somebody may be yogi, he is doing Ashtanga Yoga, then he will get what? Ashtasiddhis. There are 8 kinds of practices in Ashtanga Yoga and there are 8 kinds of perfections after practice. When you do Ashtanga Yoga, there is Ashtasiddhis. Then it's done. But spiritual Bhakti Yoga is not like that. The hearing and chanting that one does during the practice, he will continue to do, in fact, more intensely and more spontaneously after perfection also. Even in the Vaikuntha also, here we hear and chant discuss Bhagavatam. In Vaikuntha also, they are discussing Bhagavatam. Vaimanika, Salana, Sarita, Nishashwat, Gayanti, Yatra, Shamala, Kshapanani, Bhartuhu. They are constantly glorifying the Lord, even while traveling in Vaikuntha airplanes along with their consorts. Right? So, Prabhupada writes. So, other processes without any Vaikuntha realization, hands in trouble only and nothing more. So, impersonal realization of the self and the supreme is not complete because it is just an opposite conception of material personalities. The material body is overcast with 5 kinds of miserable conditions which we already discussed. So the Lord known as Vaikuntha and his abode is also known as Vaikuntha. Since Vaikuntha realization and worship can be made possible by transcendental form and sense. Next, 10th verse. Pravartate yatra rajastamastayoh.
Pravartate yatra rajastamastayoh.
Sattvam cha mishram nachakala vikrama.
Sattvam cha mishram nachakala vikrama.
Nayatra maya kimuta pare hare.
Nayatra maya kimuta pare hare.
Anuvrata yatra surasurechita.
Anuvrata yatra surasurechita.
The material modes of ignorance and passion do not prevail, nor is there any of their influence in goodness. There is no predominance of the influence of time. So what to speak of the illusory external energy? It cannot enter that region. Without discrimination, both the demigods and the demons worship the Lord as devotees.
So the qualities of this transcendental abode of Vaikuntha are described in the 10th verse. Pravartate yatra rajas tamas tayohu. So in the material world, this raja and tama, passion and ignorance would not prevail. There is no raja guna, there is no tamo guna. So what are the activities of this raja and tama in this material world? Raja induces creation and tama destruction. So the qualities of raja and tama cause creation and destruction in this world. In the spiritual world, Raja and Tama are not present. That means no destruction, no creation. So spiritual world is never created and it is never destroyed. It is eternally existing. What about Sattva? Now we mentioned about the absence of these 2 qualities in spiritual world. Coming to Sattva, Sattvam cha mishram na. So the Sattva in the spiritual world is existing, but it is not mixed with Raja and Tama. In the material world, there is Sattva, but it is always tinged with Rajas and Tama. So the goodness in the material world is always mixed with passion and ignorance. But in the spiritual world, the goodness is never mixed with passion and ignorance because they are not there only. That means that is Vishuddha Sattva. So what is the quality of spiritual world? Pravartate yatra Rajas Tamas tayoh Sattvam cha mishram na cha kala vikramah. Not only that. 3 things we discussed so far. No passion, no ignorance, and pure goodness without tinged with passion and ignorance. 4th quality is nacha kala vikramaha. So time has no influence in the spiritual world. So nayatra kalaha prabhavet parah prabhu natasmate natha sadangri pankajam virincha vairincha surendra vanditam parayanam kshemam ihechatam param nayatra kalaha prabhavet parah prabhu. So the Lord is never influenced by the time factor. For someone who is completely influenced by this time factor and modes, for him to come out of it, he has to take shelter of someone who is beyond it. That is Lord. So just like Lord is beyond the influence of time, Lord's abode is also beyond the influence of time. That's what is mentioned here. Nacha kala vikramaha. So the influence of kala is not there. And not only that, nayatra maya kimuta pare hare. There is no maya also. This maya refers to the external maya, right? So the external illusory energy of the Lord also will have no influence in the spiritual world. In the spiritual world, no Raja, no Tama, no Kala, no Maya, and there is Sattva, but that is not tinged with Raja and Tama. So these are the qualities of spiritual world. Anuvrata yatra surasurarchitah. So Anuvrata means devotees. Spiritual world is filled with so many devotees. So in the spiritual world, you will not find some karmi in some corners, or some jnanis sitting there, or some yogis in some other corner, or some demons in some other place. It's not the major crowd in the spiritual world is devotees. It's not like that. The only crowd in spiritual world is devotees. Only devotees exist there. No other category of people will not exist, right? They may be, devotees may exist in different forms. Some may have Swarupya Mukti, some may not have Swarupya Mukti, or some may be in animal body, some may be in bird bodies, etc. But they are all of one category, they are spiritual. Nobody is having any other mentalities. They have different rasas. Surasurarchitah, both the demigods and demons worship the Lord as devotees. Yeah, Asura. It's not clear. So, and all these millions and billions of universes combined together constitute 1/4 of the magnitude of whole creation of the world. Entire Lord's creation, 1/4 is material world and 3/4 is spiritual world. So even the leaves of a tree cannot be counted by a man. Nor can the hairs on his head. If a man cannot count the hairs on his head, we don't have, but if the man in the world cannot count hairs on his head, cannot count leaves on a tree which is growing right in front of his house, how can he expect to count the vibhutis of the Lord, which are manifest throughout the material universe? How can he count the number of planets in the universe? How can he count the number of places in a planet? How can he count the number of universes in this entire material world? And what is the possibility for him to estimate the extent of the spiritual world? So, however, foolish men are puffed up with the idea of becoming God himself. And this is the situation of a living entity in this material world, but he wants to become God, or he claims to be God. You worship me, he says. The sane man, therefore, without being puffed up as if he were the God of the universe, abides by the injunctions of Vedic literature. So a sane man has this sense of subordination to a higher authority, to a superior authority. Sense of subordination to a superior power or superior book or superior personality or superior process. So is the quality of a sane person. Always challenging and rebelling the supreme authority is not the function or not the attitude of a sane person. So the inhabitants of Vaikuntha planets are all Brahma Bhuta living entities, as distinguished from the mundane creatures. The rope accepted as a snake may be an illusion of a particular person. Prabhupada brings out another thing. So on one hand, there are some people who just want to enjoy this material world. On the other hand, there are other personalities who reject this material world as illusion. Brahma Satyam Jagan Mithya. They say this material world is false, right? It's not existing. So, Prabhupada says, they give the example of rope and snake. Yes, rope, the mentality of accepting a rope as a snake or snake as a rope is illusion, definitely. But rope is not an illusion. Snake is not an illusion. Factually, rope exists and snake also exists. But your conception or perception of seeing a rope to be a snake, that is illusion. Similarly, the material world exists, spiritual world also will exist. But your conception of perceiving this temporary material world as permanent, that is illusion. Right? That is the Vaishnava's understanding. Same, another example Prabhupada gives, desert. So in the desert, some people may perceive water, mirage. But water is not existing. But water doesn't exist there, but it exists somewhere else. So desert is also there, water is also there. But your perception of water in the desert when there is no water, that is illusion. Similarly, material world is also there because it is manifested by Lord's potency, external energy. But the energy of the Lord is not all. This energy of the Lord is not all. The Lord has internal energy also with which He manifests this Vaikuntha atmosphere as described in the 10th verse. So, Vaikuntha atmosphere is enriched with spiritual transcendental qualities. So, the sattvam there is not mixed with Raja and Tama. So, through sattva there is maintenance. We have described that there is no creation and destruction in the spiritual world because there is no Raja and Tama. But there is no sattva also in the spiritual world which is mixed with Raja and Tama. Thus, there is no maintenance of temporary planets like Swarga. So, in the material world, there is sattva through which maintenance happens. But what kind of maintenance is that? Maintaining some temporary planets and temporary things in this world. That's why that sattva here is not pure. But there is pure sattva in the spiritual world, composed of satchit. So, because of the complete absence of mundane qualities of ignorance and passion, there is no question of anything created or annihilated that we have discussed. Next, 11th verse. Prabhupada also comments on Anuvrata. Anuvrata yatra surasura architaha. Anuvrata is everyone is there is a follower of the Lord. The Lord is the chief leader there without any competition for leadership. And the people are in general are all followers of the Lord. Next.
ಶ್ಯಾಮಾವದಾತಃ ಶತಪತ್ರಲೋಚನಃ
inhabitants of the Vaikuntha planets are displayed as having a sky bluish complexion. Their eyes resemble lotus flowers. Their dress is of yellowish color, and their bodily features very attractive. They are just the age of growing years. They all have four hands. They are all nicely decorated with pearl necklaces and ornamental medallions.
So after describing the Lord's abode, Sukadeva Goswami describes the inhabitants of that abode. So Shyamavadataha Satapatra Lochanaha. So they are having the complexion of sky blue. Sky bluish. Avadataha, they are glowing. Satapatra Lochanaha, their eyes are resembling lotus petals. Pishanga vastraha, they wear yellowish garments. Surachaha supeshavaha, they are greatly attractive, they are very youthful, there is no old age there. Sarve chaturbahava unmishanmani, everybody is having four hands. So, praveka nishka bharanaha subarchasaha, they are wearing such wonderful ornaments of superior quality, they are very effulgent. So, these are the qualities of all the Vaikuntha residents. So, more description of Vishnu Dutas can be found in 6th Canto, 1st chapter, when there was a conversation between Yamadutas and Vishnu Dutas. Vishnu Dutas suddenly appear there and their bodily features are also described. So, the features of Vishnu Dutas are the people who associate with the Lord in the spiritual world are not to be found in this material world. So, as there are different bodily features in different places of a particular planet, or there are different bodily features between bodies in different planets, similarly, the bodily features of the inhabitants of Vaikuntha Loka are completely different from those in the material universe, like that. And Vishnachakravarti Thakur also says red, black, green, white. So, those people are of different complexions also. All are very attractive. So, we can't conceive of somebody roaming in green color, red color, like that, but they appear very wonderful there. So, next 12th verse. Pravala vaidurya mrinala varchasaha ಪರಿಸ್ಫುರತ್ ಕುಂಡಲ ಮೌಲಿ ಮಾಲಿನ ಪ್ರವಾಲ ವೈದೂರ್ಯ ಮೃಣಾಲ ವರ್ಚಸಃ ದೇರ್ ಸಮ್ ಆಫ್ ದೆಮ್ ಆರ್ ರೆಫಲ್ಜೆಂಟ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಕೋರಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಡೈಮಂಡ್ಸ್ ಇನ್ ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಪರಿಸ್ಫುರತ್ ಕುಂಡಲ ಮೌಲಿ ಮಾಲಿನ ಅಂಡ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ವೇರಿಂಗ್ ಬ್ಯೂಟಿಫುಲ್ ಇಯರ್ ರಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದೇ ಆರ್ ರೆಸ್ಪ್ಲೆಂಡೆಂಟ್ ವಿತ್ ಬ್ಯೂಟಿಫುಲ್ ಗಾರ್ಲೆಂಡ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಬ್ಲೂಮಿಂಗ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಲೋಟಸ್ ಫ್ಲವರ್ಸ್ ಪರಿಸ್ಫುರತ್ ಸೊ ಪ್ರಭಾತ್ ರೈಟ್ಸ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಸಾರೂಪ್ಯ ಮುಕ್ತಿ ಹಿಯರ್ 13th ವರ್ಸ್ ಭ್ರಾಜಿಷ್ಣುಭಿರ್ಯ ಪರಿತೋ ವಿರಾಜತೆ ಎಲ್ಲ ಸದ್ವಿಮಾನಾವಲಿಭಿರ್ ಮಹಾತ್ಮನ ವಿದ್ಯೋತಮಾನ ಪ್ರಮದೋತ್ತಮಾಯುಧ ಸವಿದ್ಯುದರ್ಹಾವಲಿಭಿರ್ಯಥಾನಭ
Vaikuntha planets are also surrounded by various airplanes, all glowing and brilliantly situated. These airplanes belong to the great Mahatmas or devotees of the Lord. The ladies are as beautiful as lightning because of their celestial complexions. And all these combined together appear just like the sky decorated with both clouds and lightning.
So, Bharajishnubhir, yaha parito virajate. So, in the Vaikuntha Loka, the sky is decorated with beautiful airplanes. In the airplanes, there are Vishnu's devotees along with their consorts. Sallasad Vimanali Bhir, Vimanali, Vimana is airplane. Vimanali means groups of airplanes, right, assemblies. So, Lasad Vimanali Bhir Mahatmanam, all Mahatma devotees are there. ವಿದ್ಯೋತಮಾನಃ ಪ್ರಮದಾಯುತ್ ಪ್ರಮದೋತ್ತಮ ಪ್ರಮದ ಉತ್ತಮ ಮೀನ್ಸ್ ಬೆಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವುಮೆನ್ ಸೊ ಆಲ್ ದಿ ಸೆಲೆಸ್ಟಿಯಲ್ ವುಮೆನ್ ಆರ್ ದೇರ್ ಸೊ ಅಭ್ಯುದ್ಭಿಹಿ ದೇ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಸಚ್ ಬ್ಯೂಟಿಫುಲ್ ಕಾಂಪ್ಲೆಕ್ಷನ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಎಲೆಕ್ಟ್ರಿಕ್ ಲೈಟನಿಂಗ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪ್ರೊಪಸಸ್ ದೆನ್ ಅಬ್ರಾವಲಿಭಿ ದೇ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದ ಸ್ಕೈ ಇಸ್ ಡೆಕೊರೇಟೆಡ್ ವಿತ್ ಕ್ಲೌಡ್ಸ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಲೈಟನಿಂಗ್ ಸೊ ದ ಮೆನ್ ಆ್ಯಂಡ್ ವುಮೆನ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಏರ್ಪ್ಲೇನ್ಸ್ ರಿಸೆಂಬಲ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಟ್ So even in the third canto also Brahmaji describes Vaikuntha to all the demigods. So when Diti was pregnant, because she was holding the pregnancy for about 100 years, not trying to deliver Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu because they might create some trouble to the demigods, or it was already predicted that Hiranyaksha and Hiranyakashipu will be killed by Vishnu. So Diti was holding pregnancy and that caused a lot of darkness in the universe. Then all the demigods went to Brahmaji. What is the reason for this darkness? Why are we getting suffocated? Then he explains flashback. So how Jaya and Vijaya cursed. Jaya and Vijaya were cursed by four Kumaras when they went to Vaikuntha. In that context he describes the glories of Vaikuntha. Something similar here. Here Brahmaji saw Vaikuntha, there Brahmaji describes Vaikuntha. There also he says, ವೈಮಾನಿಕ ಸಲಲನಶ್ಚರಿತಾನಿ ಶಶ್ವತ್ ಗಾಯಂತಿ ಯತ್ರ ಶಮಲ ಕ್ಷಪಣಾನಿ ಭರ್ತು ಅಂತರ್ಜಲೇನು ವಿಕಸನ್ ಮಧುಮಾನಿ ಮಧುಮಾಧವೀನ ಗಂಧೇನ ಖಂಡಿತ ಧಿಯೋ ಪ್ಯನಿಲಂ ಕ್ಷಿಪಂತಃ ಅಂಡ್ ಹಿ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಸೇಸ್ ಅನದರ್ ಬ್ಯೂಟಿಫುಲ್ ವರ್ಸ್ ಯತ್ ಸಂಕುಲಂ ಹರಿಪದಾನತಿ ಮಾತ್ರ ದೃಷ್ಟೈರ್ ವೈದೂರ್ಯ ಮಾರಕತ ಹೇಮಮಯೈರ್ ವಿಮಾನೈ ಸೊ ಆಲ್ ದಿ ರೆಸಿಡೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಆಫ್ ವೈಕುಂಠ ಹರಿಪದಾನತಿ ಮಾತ್ರ ದೃಷ್ಟೈರ್ ದೇರ್ ದೃಷ್ಟಿ ದೇರ್ ಹೋಲ್ concentration is totally on Lord Hari's lotus feet. And they travel in Vaikuntha airplanes. Vaidurya marakata hema mayair vimanaihi. So their airplanes are decorated with Vaidurya gems. Right? Marakata, hema is golden airplanes. Right? Which are bedecked with all these costly, valuable gems. Gems of Vaikuntha. Then, yesham brahat katitata smita shobhi mukhyaha. And they are also accompanied by beautiful concerts. We have no airplane and there are beautiful concerts. Brihat kadi tataha. They have very wonderful bodily features. Right? Smita shobhi mukhyaha. Smiling faces, beautiful glances. So, but Krishnatmanam. They are completely absorbed in Krishna. Na raja adadhurutsmayadhyir. The passionate desires to enjoy on a sensual plane will not enter even their minds. because they are Krishnatmanam and they are Haripadanati Matra Drishtaya. Their focus is only on Krishna. So, similar description is coming here also. So, they may not be like driven machines, right? Because everything in the same, is of the same nature of eternity, bliss and knowledge. The airplanes also are of the same quality of spiritual nature. So, after describing the inhabitants and the airplanes and their activities, Sukadeva Goswami now describes the goddess of fortune in the spiritual world. That is the 14th verse. Shri Yatra Rupin Yurugaya Padayoha
Shri Yatra Rupin Yurugaya Padayoha
Karoti Manam Bahudha Vibhuti Bhi
Karoti Manam Bahudha Vibhuti Bhi
Prengham Shritaya Kusuma Karanugair
Prengham Shritaya Kusuma Karanugair
Vigiyamana Priya Karma Gayati
Vigiyamana Priya Karma Gayati.
The goddess of fortune in her transcendental form is engaged in loving service of the Lord's lotus feet, and being moved by the black bees, followers of spring, she is not only engaged in variegated pleasure service to the Lord along with her constant companions, but is also engaged in singing the glories of Lord's activities.
So these are the activities of goddess of fortune. Shri Yatra Rupin Yurugaya Padayoho. Shri is the Shakti of the Lord, and she is engaged in glorifying the Lord, right? So Sri Rupini, she is also having such transcendental form. So Urugaya Padayoho, and she is accompanied by other devotees, and then she is singing the glories of the Lord. Karoti Manam Bahudha Vibhuti Bhi, and she also renders beautiful service to the Lord. Janudvaya Jalajalochanaya Jananya Lakshmyakhilasya Swaravanditaya Vidhatuhu. So this Mother Lakshmi, she constantly massages the feet of Lord Narayana. Janudvaya. Janu is the portion between the feet and the knees, right, the calves. She is constantly seen pressing the calves of Vishnu. Janudvaya Jalajalochanaya means she is lotus-eyed Jananya, mother. The lotus-eyed mother is constantly massaging the feet of the Lord. Then Lakshmya Khilasya Swaravanditaya Vidhatuhu. Lakshmya, this Mother Lakshmi, is Akhila Swaravanditaya. She is offered obeisances by great demigods. Right? So Prenkam Shritaya Kusumanu Kusumankaranu Gayu. And accompanied by her personal associates, she is moving there. That movement is of enjoyment, and she has taken shelter of the lotus feet of the Lord, right? So Vigiyamana Priya Karma Gayati, and accompanied by all these people and bees especially, she is singing the glories of the Lord. Vigiyamana, along with her constant companions, like that. So 15th verse, after describing the activities of goddess of fortune, Sukadeva Goswami again comes to the activities of the Supreme Lord. 15th verse is about the Supreme Lord. Dadarsha tatra khila sattvatam patim
Dadarsha tatra khila sattvatam patim
Shriyah patim yagna patim jagat patim
Shriyah patim yagna patim jagat patim
Sunandananda prabhala arhanadibhi
Sunandananda Prabhulaharanadibhi
Svaparshadangrihe Parisevitam Vibhu
Svaparshadangrihe Parisevitam Vibhu.
Lord Brahma saw in Vaikuntha planets the personality of Godhead, who is the Lord of the entire devotee community, the Lord of the goddesses of fortune, the Lord of all sacrifices and the Lord of the universe, and who is served by the foremost servitors like Nanda, Sunanda, Prabhala and Arhana, his immediate associates.
Dadarsha, Brahmaji saw, what? Tatra akhila sattvatam patihi. So here Lord is described in various ways. One is sattvatam patihi. So he is the Lord of all devotees. Right? He is sattvatam patihi. Next, shriyah patihi. He is the Lord of all wealth, Lord of goddess of fortune. That's why he is called shriyah patihi. Third, yajna patim. He is the Lord of all sacrifices. Fourth, Jagatpatim, he is the lord of all universes, all planets. So he is Satvatam Pati, Shriyaha Pati, then Yajnapati and Jagatpati. So Sunanda Nanda Prabalarhanadibhi, he is worshipped by his companions like Nanda and Sunanda. Sunanda, Nanda and other people. Right? So Prabala Arhanadibhi. So Swaparshada, they are all his own associates. Agraihi Parishevitam Vibhum. He is served by them. So the king is accompanied by his confidential associates. So king has this whole entourage and all the other ministers and servants. Similarly, Lord is also accompanied by his servants. Right? 16th verse.
Many times in Nanda and Sunanda, these persons are coming.
So Dhruva Maharaj, when he was brought to Vaikuntha, they also come. Mm-hmm. Right? So they are counted as one of the prominent associates of Vishnu in Vaikuntha. So more details, we need to see some other references. Within Bhagavatam, they may come only in this couple of places. 16th verse. So Lord's beauty is described in the 16th verse. Bhritya prasada vimukam durgasavam.
Bhritya prasada vimukam durgasavam.
Prasannaha saruna locha nolasan.
Prasannaha saruna locha nolasan.
Kiritinam kundalinam chaturbhujam.
Kiritinam kundalinam chaturbhujam.
Pitam sukam vakshasi lakshitam shriya.
Pitam sukam vakshasi lakshitam shriya.
Bhritya prasada vimukam. So, Lord is constantly showering His favor upon His devotees. Bhritya means His servants. Prasada abhimukham. Abhimukham means inclined. So, Lord is always inclined, favorably inclined towards His devotees. Right? So, then Durgasavam. Durgasavam. Asavam literally means intoxication. Durgasavam. The vision of the Lord is intoxicating. So, one who sees the beautiful form of the Lord gets intoxicated by that beauty. So, it is so attractive and so enchanting. So, Chakravarti Pad translates this as giver of joy to those who see Him. That's why His form is described as Darshaniya Tamam Shantam Mano Nayana Vardhanam. Darshaniya Tamam. So, Darshaniya, Darshaniya Tara, Darshaniya Tama. Darshaniya means worth seeing. Darshaniyatara means it's like wonderful thing that you have to see. Darshaniyatama means best of all wonderful things that you can see. It can't be better than this. So Darshaniyatamam, Shantam, Manonayana Vardhanam. One's mind and heart and eyes are completely satisfied by seeing the Lord. That's why he is described as Dhrik Asavam. Even not only his vision is intoxicating, his qualities are also intoxicating. His hearing about him is also intoxicating. So Kardamamani says in the third canto, when the Lord Vishnu presents himself in front of Kardamamani, Kardamamani says, Piyusha Niryapita Deha Dharmaha. And how does the verse begin? You know, bro? Piyusha Niryapita Deha Dharmaha. So the beginning, so basically it is describing that how the Lord's glories are both intoxicating and also nectarian. Lokamscha lokam lokanu gatam pasumscha hitvashritaste charanata patram parasparam tad gunavada sidhuhu piyusha niryapita deha dharma. Parasparam tad gunavada sidhuhu. So sidhu and piyusha means Lord's glories would act like intoxicant and also nectar, right? So like that, Lord's form and Lord's glories are described to be intoxicating. Then third attribute of the Lord, prasanna hasaruna lochanananam. So his face is beautifully decorated with eyes and glances, aruna lochana ananam. Then prasanna, very pleasant face, right? So prasanna. Prasanna is very pleasing face, very much pleased. Hasa Aruna Lochan Olasan. His smile and his glances are like that. Then Kiritinam Kundalinam Chaturbhujam. He is wearing a beautiful crown. This is not a description of Krishna in Vrindavan. It is a description of Vishnu in Vaikuntha. So, he wears crown. He doesn't wear turban. So, Kiritinam Kundalinam. Beautiful earrings. Chaturbhujam. Four hands. So, four arms. Pitam Sukam. Yellowish cloth. Vakshasi Lakshita Shriya. And his chest is also marked with Goddess of Fortune. Right? So, these are the descriptions of the Supreme Lord. Next, Tarunam Ramaniyangam Arunoshtekshanadharam Pranatashrayanam Rumnam Sharanyam Karunaranavam. So, Lord's youthful body is perfectly formed. All the limbs of Lord's body are perfectly shaped. So, he is not fat or thin or anything like that. At that age, whatever should be the size of a perfect human being, Lord will manifest that much only. Right, when he is in Vrindavan. So, the particular place where the Lord's audience is available for his eternal devotees is called Yogapitha. So, Lord's beauty is described in the 16th verse. The 17th verse describes Lord's energies. Adharyaha Niyasanam Asthitam Param. Vritam Chatushodasha Pancha Shakti Bhi.
Vritam Chatushodasha Pancha Shakti Bhi.
Yuktam Bhagai Swair Itaratra Chadruvaihi.
Yuktam Bhagai Swair Itaratra Chadruvaihi.
Svaeva Dhaman Ramamanam Ishwaram.
Svaeva Dhaman Ramamanam Ishwaram.
The Lord was seated on his throne and was surrounded by different energies like the 4, the 16, the 5 and the 6 natural princes, along with other insignificant energies of the 10 30 characters. But it was the actual Supreme Lord enjoying his universe.
So, Abhyarhaniya, Lord is very worshipable, greatly worshipable. So, he is sitting on throne. Asanam Asthitam. So, he is sitting on his throne in the spiritual world. Paramvritam, and he is supreme personality of Godhead, and he is surrounded by Chatuhu, four. So, Lord's energies are mentioned here. So, these four energies are either Dharma, Jnana, Aishwarya, Vairagya or Prakriti, Purusha, Mahat and Ahankara. So, these are the, sometimes the Lord's energies are counted in various ways. So, here when you say four energies of the Lord, immediately one may give these references. Then, Shodasha means 16. So, what are the 16 energies? So, they are considered to be the five senses and five gross elements and also the mind and five senses, actually two sets of five senses are there. Five working senses and five knowledge senses. Right, five Jnanendriyas and five Karmendriyas and five elements, earth, water, fire, air, ether and also mind. So, these are the 16. So, next, Chatuhu Shodasha Pancha. This another five that refers to five Tanmatras, sense objects. Right. So, like taste, smell, all this. Next, Shakti Bihi. So, total 4 plus 16 plus 5, total 25. So, all these 25 elements personified are worshipping the Lord. Okay. So, they are serving the Lord. And also there are some insignificant Shaktis also like Ashtasiddhis. They also are personified and are worshipping the Lord. So, Brahmaji got this darshan in the beginning of the creation where all the opulences and Shaktis of the Lord are worshipping the Lord in personified forms. Brahmaji got a similar darshan after Brahma Vimohan Leela. There also he saw so many millions and millions of Vishnu forms who are like through which Krishna manifested all these cowherd boys and also the calves. So, they all transformed into Vishnu forms and all the personified opulences started worshipping these forms. So, Brahmaji got vision there also. So, the living being by severe penance and performance of bodily exercises can temporarily attain some wonderful power, but that does not make him the Supreme Lord. But the Lord has all these 16 opulences or Ashtasiddhis innate in him. He doesn't have to endeavor. to get Ashtasiddhis, Lord does not have to perform Ashtanga Yoga. In the material world, a yogi has to perform these 8 limbs, Yama, Niyama, Asana, Pranayama, etc. to get Ashtasiddhis like Anima, Mahima, Laghima, etc. But Lord does not have to do all that. So, Lord is more powerful than any other yogi. So, Prabhupada says, how the Lord outsmarts everybody in the possession of powers and opulences. So, no one is equal to him, no one can go beyond him. So for example, Trinavarta, he is a great mystic yogi. So, he had this power to become this wind, whirlwind, and he came and captured Krishna. When Trinavarta came to capture Krishna, Krishna became as light as a feather. When wind comes, feathers and leaves and twigs, they just fly in the wind, right? Similarly, Krishna became as light as a feather so that Trinavarta can catch him and take him up. And Trinavarta took him 800,000 miles high. And there Krishna manifested his other siddhi. Earlier he became lighter than the lightest. Now he is becoming heavier than the heaviest. So he caught the neck of Trinavarta, and he is not living only. And he is so heavy. So far Trinavarta got Krishna's weight as just lighter than feather. But now when he became heavy like a mountain peak, Trinavarta could not go further. 800,000 miles is the limit for him. He could not go beyond. And whenever something is heavy, you try to lift this tail, it's too heavy for you, you just drop it. So Trinavarta could not drop Krishna because Krishna just caught him. And Krishna, he was absorbed in the mood of an infant. He was not playing the role of a supreme personality of Godhead there. In Vrindavan, Krishna's speciality is, he is absorbed in his mood of infancy or childhood or boyhood or youthhood, and his energies will manifest in him whenever there is a need, and they will do the needful. So Krishna was playing the role of an infant. Whenever small children are lifted up out of fear, they just catch the finger of the elder and then they become little fearful, right? So similarly, Krishna became fearful. He saw so much height. He was fearful and then caught the neck of Trinavarta tightly. That's all. And that fellow died. So when Krishna was holding the neck of Trinavarta, he was hanging from his neck. It was like Trinavarta decorated with a blue locket. Right? A small nice necklace with a blue locket is there. Pendant is there around Trinavarta's neck. So Krishna could outsmart the yogic power of Trinavarta. So Trinavarta definitely must have some yogic powers with which he becomes lighter or heavier, and then he go up, but he cannot outsmart Krishna. Although Krishna was not changing his form, he was 1 year old baby only. Same thing with Potana. Potana can change her form. She tried to give milk to a 6 days old baby Krishna. So Krishna also respected her motherly reciprocation. He remained like a small 6 days old baby only, an infant baby trying to drink milk from mother. But his energies manifested and Putana's life here also was sucked out. So, the speciality of Krishna's Vrindavan pastimes is that Krishna doesn't compromise on his mood of infancy or childhood, but he will manifest all his powers. So, no one can outsmart Krishna in exhibition of his powers. Here, Prabhupada writes that the Supreme Lord by his own potency is unlimitedly more powerful than any yogi. He is unlimitedly more powerful than any jnani. So he spoke Gita just within a short time, and people are trying to figure out what is the meaning for so many hundreds of years to come. He is unlimitedly richer than any wealthy person. So in Dwaraka, overnight Krishna manifested such an opulent abode, and he maintained 16,108 princesses, each in a palace, not just one room in one big building. Each had their own buildings, right? So who can, and through each of them he got 10 sons and 1 daughter. So 16,108 daughters plus 16,108 into 10 sons, just from one Krishna only. And they also had their sons, their daughters like that. So his wealth is unlimited. He is unlimitedly more charitable than any philanthropist, and he is more renounced like that. In any of these opulences, Krishna can never be defeated by anyone else. So the yogis are dependent on his mercy. Prabhupada writes the last few lines. out of his immensely charitable disposition, he can award some temporary powers to the yogis because of the yogis' hankering after them. But to his unalloyed devotees, who do not want anything from the Lord save and accept his transcendental service, the Lord is so pleased that he gives him in exchange his unalloyed service. So when the Lord is giving an opportunity to render service to him or his devotees, Lord is more favorable to such a person than any yogis who are trying to get some mystic siddhis and other things. That's why he says, Sadhavo Hradayam Mahyam Sadhunam Hradayam Tvaham. Right. So he is controlled by his devotees. Evam Sandarshita Hyanga Harina Bhritya Vashyata. So to exhibit his quality of being controlled by his devotees, so Krishna is bound by his mother Yashoda. Krishna is defeated by his friends, Sakhas in Vrindavan, in their mock fights, like that. So next verse, 18th verse. Tadarshanahlada pariplutantaro
Tadarshanahlada pariplutantaro
Hrishyattanu prema bharashru lochana
Hrishyattanu prema bharashru lochana
Nanama padam bhujamasya vishvashrig
Nanama padam bhujamasya vishvashrig
Yat paramahamsyena pathadhi gamyate
Yat paramahamsyena pathadhi gamyate
Lord Brahma, thus seeing the personality of Godhead in his fullness, was overwhelmed with joy within his heart, and thus in full transcendental love and ecstasy, his eyes filled with tears of love. He thus bowed down before the Lord. That is the way of the highest perfection for the living beings.
So this verse describes Brahmaji's reaction upon seeing the Lord in his abode. So tad darshana ahlada pariplutantaro. So after seeing the darshan of the Lord, there is ahalada, there is a lot of pleasure in the heart of Brahmaji, antaro. So harishyat tanuhu prema bharashru lochanaha. His body is, the hairs of the body are standing on end and is very happy physically also. And prema bharashru lochanaha, his eyes are shedding tears. Right? Nanama padam bhujamasya vishvashrut. So he is offering obeisances to the lotus feet of the Lord. Yat paramahamsyena pratadhi gamyate. And the Lord is followed by this paramahamsas, means pure devotees who do bhakti yoga. So the reaction of great devotees upon seeing the Lord is described in various contexts. Prahlad Maharaj is so happy seeing the Lord, and Dhruva Maharaj was happy, Bhutu Maharaj was happy, then also Chitraketu Maharaj. So his happiness upon seeing Lord Sankarshan is also described like this. So Srimad Bhagavatam is meant for these paramahamsas, liberated persons. So completely free from malice. In the beginning of Bhagavatam also it is mentioned, Nirmatsaranam satam vedyam vastava matra vastu shivadam tapatrayon mulanam. So it is understandable by pure-hearted, non-envious devotees. Nirmatsaranam satam vedyam. Even at the end of Bhagavatam also same message is mentioned. Srimad Bhagavatam Puranam Avalam Yadvaishnavanam Priyam Yasmin Paramahamsyam Ekam Avalam Jnanam Param Giyate Tatra Jnana Viraga Bhakti Sahitam Naishkarmyam Avishkritam Tat Srunvan Supathan Vicharana Paro Bhaktya Vimuchyennaraha. Srimad Bhagavatam Puranam Amalam. It is a spotless Purana. Yad Vaishnavanam Priyam. It is very dear to all Vaishnavas. Yasmin Paramahamsyam Ekam Amalam. So it is understandable by spotless, pure devotees who are completely devoid of envy. Yasmin Paramahamsyam Ekam Amalam. Jnanam Param Gyate. It propounds the highest knowledge. Tatra Jnana Viraga Bhakti Sahitam Naishkarmyam Avishkritam. It launches or it inaugurates the process of devotional service accompanied by knowledge and detachment and other things, naishkarmya, that activity which is devoid of any fruitive mentality, material motives. That is the subject matter of Srimad Bhagavatam. Tatra jnana viraga bhakti sahitam naishkarmyam avishkritam. So what is our duty? Tat shrunvan, one has to read. Supathan, one has to study. Vicharanaparo, one has to contemplate on it. Bhaktya vimuchya naraha. Whoever does it with devotion is completely liberated from this material existence. So, Srimad Bhagavatam is meant for persons purely, completely free from malice. So, unfortunately, persons with impious backgrounds do not believe in the personality of Godhead, and everyone wants to become God Himself without any qualification. Therefore, the Paramahamsa stage of life can be attained only by those who are fixed in the practice of Bhakti Yoga. Brahmaji believed in this art of Bhakti Yoga. One should first, with all conviction, believe in the personality of Godhead, and without making efforts to realize Him by speculative philosophy, one should prefer to hear about Him from Srimad Bhagavad Gita and later from Srimad Bhagavatam. One should hear such discourses from person Bhagavatam and not from professional men. That is the secret of learning this science. So, Prabhupada, in this context, he quotes this verse. Jnane prayasa mudapasya namanta eva jivanti sanmukharita bhavadiya vartaha. So, one has to give up this speculative endeavor to cultivate knowledge. Jnane prayasa. Give up that prayasa. Udapasya. Namanta eva. Offer obeisances. To whom? Jivanti sanmukharitam bhavadiya vartaha. To those great devotees who glorify Krishna and His activities. Go and learn about the science of Krishna from those great devotees. Jivanti sanmukharitam bhavadiya vartaha. Sthane sthitaha. You don't have to change your profile. Right, where whichever ashram or whichever varna you may be in, you can continue to be there. You can do the activities that you are doing, but always follow the instructions of these great souls. Always hear about Krishna from them. Right, sthane sthitaha. Shrutigatam tanuvan manobhir. Shrutigatam. May your gati, may your path that you are traversing in your life should be guided by this Shruti, the Shravanam, the spiritual sound vibration being emanated by such great souls. Shruti gatam tanuvan manobhir ye prayaso ajita jitopi ajitais trilokyam. Although the Lord is unconquerable in the three worlds, still Lord becomes conquerable by such a person who dedicates to the process of hearing from bona fide devotees. So give up personal endeavors to cultivate speculative knowledge, but take knowledge from Supreme Lord. Take knowledge from the devotees of the Supreme Lord. That is the message here. So, from 9th verse till the 18th verse, we have seen what Brahmaji has perceived. Right? Brahmaji's darshan of Mahavaikuntha and the Supreme Lord and the Goddess of Fortune, and how he is being worshipped by all the energies of the Lord and the devotees of the Lord, we have seen till now. Now, from the 19th verse till 25th verse, we will see what Brahmaji, what the Lord speaks to Brahmaji. Right? 19th verse. Tam priyamanam samupasthitam kavim.
Tam priyamanam samupasthitam kavim.
Prajavisarge nijasara sarhanam.
Prajavisarge nijasara sarhanam.
Babhasa ishat smitaso chishagira.
Babhasa ishat smitaso chishagira.
Priya priyam pritamana karesprishan.
Priyam 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 prasana karesprishan.
And seeing Brahma present before him, the Lord accepted him as a free being to control as he desired, and thus being much satisfied with him, the Lord shook hands with Brahma.
Tam priyamanam samupasthitam kavim prajavisarge nija shasanorhanam. Nija shasana arhanam. Shasana is what? Instruction. Right? Order. Nija shasana arhanam means Brahmaji is qualified to take the orders of Vishnu. Right? So priyamanam, worthy of being dear. So, the only personality who is worthy of being dear to someone is Krishna. He is darshaniyam, darshaniyatamam, and tarunam ramaniyangam arunoshtekshanadharam pranatashrenam rumnam sharanyam karunaranam. Sharanyam. Sharanyam means the person who is worthy of giving shelter. So, here, priyamanam, that is a person who is worthy of being dear. So then he started speaking. Babhasa ishat smita sochi shagira. Then he started speaking with a smile, some very enlightening words. Sochishagira means enlightening words. So priyaha priyam prita manaha kare sprishan. So Brahmaji, because of executing this bhakti yoga and following the instructions of the Lord, has become so dear to the Lord. So Lord shook hands with him. This is the original handshake, right? Shake hand. So kare sprishan, he started shaking hand with Brahmaji as if they were friends, as if they are both equals. So Prabhupada writes, the creation of the material world is not a blind thing, is not blind or accidental. The living entities are ever conditioned, who are conditioned, are thus given a chance for liberation under the guidance of his own representative like Brahma. So why does the Lord create, why is this Brahma there now to create this world? And why creation has to be done? To give another opportunity for the conditioned soul to rectify his rebellious mentality and be reinstated in his original position as supreme person, as a servant of Krishna. Right? So creation is basically an opportunity given to the conditioned soul for performing devotional service and going back to Godhead. Because in this world there are living entities who want to enjoy separately from Krishna. So Lord gives facility. Lord gives facility to such independent mentality people to enjoy separately from him. So, but once one is disconnected from the Lord, he has to suffer. That is the truth, eternal truth. So in this material world, there is enough enjoyment for the conditioned soul and there is a lot of suffering also. And along with these two, enjoyment and suffering, Lord also arranges that may there be scriptures for the guidance of these conditioned souls, and let there be my representatives, the acharyas, to guide them back to Godhead, and I will also personally descend as incarnation. So in these five ways, Lord comes to reclaim the conditioned souls. So he, because the child is so adamant, the mother gives him some toys to play. For example, Prabhupada gives this example in the fourth canto, Rudra Gita purports. When the child is so adamant, he does not want to eat the food cooked by the mother. Mother is feeding him nicely, she is making some preparations and then feeding him. And the child says, I will not eat this food, I want to cook. I will cook myself. Then the child is so adamant, he is not eating, so mother gives him some toy utensils. Okay, play with these toys. Imitation kitchen. But if the mother is sending the child directly into the kitchen, he may burn his hands, he may cut his hands, he may do something else. He doesn't know the recipe. He doesn't know how to cook. He can't even reach the height of the gas stove also. Right? So he gives him some toy utensils. So they will play with toys for some time, and after getting exhausted for 1 or 2 hours, he'll come back to mother saying, I'm hungry, please feed me. Mother is waiting for this. If the mother asks, why don't you eat the food that you have cooked? No, that is playing only. From that, I cannot mitigate my hunger. I have to eat food cooked by you only. So that is the case of the conditioned soul also. Conditioned soul want to enjoy independently from Krishna. So Krishna gave him the material world. Just like mother gave him toy utensils. But how can you enjoy separately from Krishna? For enjoyment, you have to come to Krishna only. So that is the reclaiming program. Right? So here, the Supreme Lord reclaims the conditioned souls, and Brahmaji, being a representative of the Lord, he has a great responsibility in delivering the conditioned souls, and therefore he is very dear to the Lord. The Lord is very much anxious to get back his parts and parcels, and no one is more dear than the Lord than the one who takes the task of reclaiming the fallen souls back to Godhead. So Lord's attitude towards the conditioned souls is to reclaim them. Whoever is assisting the Lord in this program becomes also dear to the Lord. That way. So enjoyment, material enjoyment, and when there is frustration, distress. So he gives facility for enjoying separately from the Lord. And also he gives frustration in that enjoyment, two things. And third is, he sends acharyas, he sends scriptures, and he personally comes and performs pastimes to attract the hearts of conditioned souls. So in all these ways, Lord tries to reclaim the souls. So Lord is pleased with the preacher. Whoever is assisting the Lord to reclaim the conditioned souls is a preacher, and that preacher is very dear to the Lord. And Lord will shake his hands with such a preacher. That's what he did now. Priyaha priyam prita manaha kare sprishan. Kare sprishan. He is shaking his hands. Now Lord starts speaking. Shri Bhagavan Uvacha.
Shri Bhagavan Uvacha.
Dvayaham toshita samyak.
Dvayaham toshita samyak.
Vedagarbha sisrikshaya.
Vedagarbha sisrikshaya.
Chirambhritena tapasa.
Chirambhritena tapasa.
Dustoshaha kuta yoginam.
Dustoshaha kuta yoginam.
The beautiful personality of God that addresses Lord Brahma. O Brahma, imprisonment with the Vedas. I am very much pleased with your long accumulated penance, with the desire for creation. Hardly am I pleased with the pseudo mystics.
Tvayaham toshitaha samyag. I am completely satisfied with you, my dear Brahmaji. Lord is saying. Vedagarbha sisirkshaya. You are Vedagarbha because you have completely assimilated the Vedas and you can impart them to anyone also. Then sisirkshaya chiram bhrityena tapasa. You have performed austerities for a long time, 1000 celestial years. For what? Sisirkshaya. For the creation of this material world. So dushto saha kota yogina. I am not pleased with kota yogis. Pseudo yogis, pseudo mystics, I am not pleased. But your tapasya is meant for satisfying me. So I am satisfied. So your tapasya is meant for creation, and that creation is my instruction only. So thus it is not a material desire. Because materialistic people also perform tapasya to get some material benediction from the Lord. So here the Brahmaji performed tapasya for creation of this world, but it is not considered material desires. Desire. Because the desire to create has been inspired by the Lord in Brahmaji. So it is not material desire. And the desire to create is meant to reclaim the conditioned souls back to Godhead. So it is not material desire. So it is not about what you desire, but it is about what, with what intention do you desire to please the Lord. So Lord is very pleased with him. So there are two kinds of penance, one for sense gratification, one for self-realization. So Prabhupada writes, even to create nuclear weapons also there is a lot of tapasya, lot of inconvenience they have to accept, lot of research they have to do, but that is meant to destroy people. So Lord is not happy with that kind of tapasya. So any kind of tapasya I am pleased, not like that. That tapasya which is meant for the welfare of people, that tapasya which is meant to please the Lord is pleasing to the Lord. So that's why he clearly says, I am not pleased with kota yogis, pseudo mystics. Varam varaya bhadram te.
Varam varaya bhadram te.
Varesham abhivanchitam.
Varesham abhivanchitam.
Brahman shreyaha parishramaha.
Brahman shreya parishramaha.
Vamsam adarshanavadhi.
Vamsam adarshanavadhi.
I wish you good luck, O Brahma. You may ask from me, the giver of all benedictions, all that you may desire. You may know that the ultimate benediction as the result of all penances is to see me by realization.
Varam varaya bhadram te. My dear Brahmaji, I will give you varam, benediction. What benedictions you want to tell me? So varesham maabhi vanchitam. Whatever vancha means wish you have, you can express. I will fulfill. So Brahman Shreya Parishramaha Pumsam Maddarshanavadihi. So the result of all these penances is to see me by realization. When I am so pleased with someone, I will exhibit myself in front of him. Because my transcendental form is not so easy to see. But I exhibit it only when I am satisfied with people. With their tapasya. So Prabhupada writes that impersonal realization, our realization of local Paramatma, localized Paramatma, is not the ultimate realization of Bhagavan. To be able to see the Lord face to face and serve him, that is the ultimate realization. 22nd verse. Manisha Manishitanubhavoyam.
Manishitanubhavoyam.
Mamalokavalokanam.
Mamalokavalokanam.
Yadupashrutya rahasi.
Yadupashrutya rahasi.
Chakartha paramam tapaha.
Chakartha paramam tapaha.
The highly
highest perfection in the is the personal perfection of my rules. And this has been possible because of rule submissive attitude and the performance of severe commands according to my order.
Manishita ingenuity. The perfection of this highest intelligence, developed intelligence, that is Manisha, is Anubhavataha, Anubhavaha Mam, to experience me and my abode. Right? Avalokanam, to be actually seeing my abode. So I am very happy. That's why I have shown my beautiful form and abode to you. So this can be attained by everyone who is willing to discharge the act of devotional service as enjoined in the revealed scriptures that are standard and accepted by the bona fide acharyas, spiritual masters. So Brahma exactly followed these principles without any superiority complex. So Brahmaji fully surrendered unto the instruction of the Lord. When the Lord said tapa tapa, Brahmaji surrendered. So Brahma exactly followed these principles without any superiority complex, and thus he attained the highest perfectional stage of experiencing the abode of the Lord and the Lord himself with all his paraphernalia. So this is not possible for any pseudo yogi. As Lord himself said in the previous verse, Kota Yogi. So everyone is falsely or factually proud of his so-called learning. Falsely or factually proud. But the Lord says that highest perfectional stage of learning is to know him and his abode, devoid of any illusion. 23rd verse. Pratyadishtam maya tatra
Vaikarma
vimohite
Tapome hridayam sakshat
Atmaham tapaso nagha.
O sinless Brahma, you may know from me that it was I who first ordered you to undergo penance when you were perplexed in your duty. Such penance is my heart and soul, and therefore penance and I are not different.
So now the Lord is revealing to Brahma, sometime back you have heard, thousand years back you have heard tapa tapa. It's me who spoke that words. So Brahmaji got the right intuition in the beginning. He tried to find the speaker by looking here and there, but he thought, let me follow him. Right? I'm unable to find him. Better let me follow the instruction. So it is Brahma, it is the Lord who has given him instruction. It is the Lord who has inspired him to meditate and follow that instruction. So now he reveals that. Not out of pride. Lord, it's just a fact telling. He has become so dear to Brahmaji. So Lord says, I only have inspired you like that to do penance, and I only spoke to you. So such penance is my heart. So one cannot enjoy material illusory prosperity if he desires to return back to Godhead. One who has no information of the transcendental bliss in the association of the Lord foolishly desires to enjoy temporary material happiness. So Prabhupada writes in this purport, especially in the first paragraph, that non-attachment for material enjoyment. So one should not be attached to this material enjoyment. One has to do some tapasya, which is ultimately meant to please the Lord. Then the Lord is very happy to reciprocate with him. Lord is happy to present himself and his abode in front of him. However, if one still have material desires, he has material desires. So what does the Lord do? He may worship the Lord, but he is having material desires. Lord just takes away all his property, material wealth. And again that person tries to endeavor to get that material wealth back, material prosperity back. Lord again takes it away. Like that, Lord will make a person fail in all his material pursuits so that he will helplessly take shelter of the Lord only. That is the way in which the Lord drags a devotee towards pure devotional service. Right? Some people are ready to surrender. Some people want to surrender, but they still have some material desires lingering in their mind. So Lord will just deprive them of any facilities to execute those material desires so that they will come and surrender. Or sometimes the Lord fulfills the material desires of a devotee in such a way that they don't desire like that anymore. For example, he desired, who is that? Dhruva Maharaj desired wealth. It was a material desire. Lord fulfilled that desire, that material ambition of sitting in a higher platform, even Brahmaji also. What this 5-year-old child is thinking is totally inconceivable. Dhruva says, I want to be superior to Brahma. I want to sit on a plane where even Brahmaji, my great grandfather also has not, did not sit. So how can someone, some person, some child in a universe think of sitting in a position which is superior to his, the superior most person in the universe, Brahmaji? So it's inconceivable. But Lord gave him that kind of position. But Lord removed that desire in him. He fulfilled the desire by nullifying that desire. So Dhruva Maharaj, when he received it, he was feeling that, why did he desire like that? So once you have given up the desire to enjoy, although the desirable object is there in front of you, you cannot enjoy it. So that's how Lord protected him. On the other hand, Avanti Brahman was there. So he wanted wealth. All his relatives and friends and family members abandoned him. So he was just taken away, all this wealth. Right, all the wealth of Avanti Brahman was taken away, and he is obliged to take shelter of the Lord, exclusive shelter of the Lord. So like that, Lord has his own ways of pulling a person towards pure devotional service. Once one approaches the Lord, akama sarva kama va moksha kama udaradhi, so Lord will take charge of him. How exactly he will pull him into pure devotional service, he knows. So Narada Muni was also a devotee, but he was a loving child of this maid servant. So Lord arranged a snake to bite his mother. Then his mother died and Narada Muni went into full-time devotional service. So Prabhupada immediately writes, this is the way of dragging a sincere soul to the lotus feet of the Lord. As soon as the mother died, Narada Muni went into pure devotional service. And definitely mother also will get better destination. She served Bhaktivedantis like that. So Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur quotes in this purport, Yasyaham Anugrahanami Harishyeta Dhanam Shanaihi. So Brahmaji has done austerities here voluntarily. If one does not have that intention to voluntarily perform austerities, Lord will force him to perform austerities. So that's what the whole theme is, the purport. Why this is being described, why we are describing Vesyaham Anugrihanami, all this, Dhruva Maharaj and all these people, Avanti Brahman, because Lord will forcefully do it. See, Prabhupada makes a brilliant statement. Last but one paragraph, last sentence. Therefore, penance in devotional service to the Lord, either by voluntary submission or being forced by the Lord, is necessary for attaining perfection. And thus, such penance is the internal potency of the Lord. So, materialistic people will do tapasya with material desires, but Brahma desired to do tapasya for creation of this world, which is inspired by the Lord only, which is a service to the Lord. So his desire is not material desire. So, but even if one does tapasya with material desires also, Lord will fulfill those desires in such a way that they don't desire any material plane again.
What are tapasyas in our current situation, for example?
Or regulative principles and doing the service given by the authorities. Fasting is there, correct.
Hearing chanting is also
tapasya, he says. So, 24th verse. Srijami tapasai vedam.
Srijami tapasai vedam.
Grasami tapasa punaha.
Grasami tapasa punaha.
Bibhrami tapasa vishwam.
Bibhrami tapasa vishwam.
Bibharmi tapasa vishwam.
Bibharmi tapasa vishwam.
Viryam me duscharam tapaha.
Viryam me duscharam tapaha.
I create this cosmos by such penance and maintain it by the same energy, and I withdraw it by all, and I withdraw it all by the same energy. Therefore, the potential power is penance only.
So the Lord glorifies tapasya here. All four lines tapasya is there. So Prabhupada writes a beautiful purport. In executing penance, one must be determined to go back to Godhead. So, and must decide to undergo all types of tribulations for that end. Even for material prosperity also, there is lot of tapasya involved. even to pass exam in material education also, there is a lot of tapasya involved. And if tapasya is involved in that end also, why not tapasya in for spiritual perfection? Prabhupada says that. So Lord is more clever than any living entity. Therefore, he wants to see how painstaking the devotee is in devotional service. The order is received from the Lord either directly or through the bona fide spiritual master, and to execute that order, however painstaking, is the severe type of penance. So, all the pains that a devotee undergoes to execute the instruction of a bona fide spiritual master and the Lord are a part of his tapasya, and that is very purifying. One who follows the principle rigidly is sure to achieve success in attaining the Lord's mercy. So, we have only 10 minutes.
What practice of devotional service did you do?
Exactly, meditation was mentioned. It's a devotional meditation, not like a yogic meditation.
Because he didn't know about the Supreme Lord, so...
No, he knows.
No, because...
Lord only inspired him to meditate upon him.
So all this description of Vaikuntha was discovered, he came to know later. So,
in the third canto, 8th chapter also, Brahmaji's meditation is described. So, Brahmaji undergoes this phase often, right? Every day begins with creation. So, Brahmaji wants to create the way he created the previous day. So, now some of this description may be referring to the very first day of Brahmaji also. Right, or any typical day of Brahma also. So now at that stage Brahmaji did not have a guru or a college or a gurukul or anything like that. So all the transmission of knowledge and knowledge about the Lord is given to Brahma through the heart by the Supreme Lord. So when Brahmaji is meditating on the Supreme Lord, that knowledge and inspiration to meditate is coming from the Lord only. Tene Brahma Hridayadi Kavaye. Right in the first verse it is mentioned, Tene Brahma Hridayadi Kavaye. So at this point Brahmaji, apparently he doesn't know anything. He is the only person created, and then who taught him to meditate? What kind of bhakti is he doing? Lord inspired him to do bhakti. Lord inspired him to meditate on Brahmaji. And this 1000 years, what was his itinerary? What was his daily schedule, and how exactly he has done those details, at least I am not aware, I didn't read anywhere. But he was doing bhakti. It's a devotional meditation. Unless he does bhakti, why would he see Vaikuntha? That's how Prabhupada gives an argument. But that inspiration is coming from the Lord, knowledge is coming from the Lord, from within. So, we have hardly 7 minutes, we will not take more verses. But I will summarize what will Brahma speak next. And next week we can see. So Brahmaji now basically asks 4 questions to the Lord. First he says, I want to know about your material and spiritual forms. Next, I want to know about your spiritual energies and material energies. Third, I want to know about your activities in relation with those material and spiritual energies. And the 4th question was very important. It's not a question, it's basically a request. My dear Lord, I want to perform this service of creation, but I want to do it without getting entangled by Maya. Because I am the first person and I am doing this most important service, I may be puffed up. I may become proud in my activities of being a creator. So, please protect me from false pride and this sense of doership. So that was his 4th question or request. So these are the 4 questions he would ask. And as an answer to these 4, the Supreme Lord speaks Chatushloki Bhagavatam. 4 verses are answer to these questions. So Brahmaji, right in the beginning of creation only, he was exhibiting his fear of fall down, and he is offering a prayer for protection. FFPP. So fear of fall down, prayer for protection. So right in the beginning he was doing that, and he did this entire creation depending on the Supreme Lord. He was not having this independent doership mentality. He was depending on the Supreme Lord. So we can learn that. And having a healthy fear of Maya, having healthy fear of being deviated from the process and becoming proud of our accomplishments. So it should be a part of any practitioner that Brahmaji is teaching us. So thank you all very much. Granthara Srimad Bhagavatam ki jaya. Srimad Prabhupada ki jaya.